Trinity. My name is John Schantz, and I'll also be serving as your lay leader today. First, I want to say that we are blessed this morning to be welcomed in by the Ohio Light Opera, members of the Ohio Light Opera. Our string quartet is comprised of Alistair Watson, Beth Yunchuk, Emily Grissing, and Eva Rakova, and we're very appreciative that they graced us with their music here this morning. For announcements this morning, we are in great need of ushers, greeters, and some nursery help for the summer. Please sign up in the narthex if you are able to help us out. We're also in need of volunteers for Downtown Vacation Bible School. See Melissa if you can help, or if you have any questions. Don't forget to register your children if you haven't done so yet. Also, tomorrow is the deadline to sponsor our senior high mission t-shirts. Forms are available in the narthex, so please make sure to look at those before you leave today. Our first North Street Mission group of the season was here this past week, and they had to leave yesterday, but they did leave a few notes of their experience. Quote, it was an eye-opening experience, and it was a great way to start off my mission trips. And another tip for future volunteers, quote, you will see things that will change your life. And we're grateful that they were able to come and use our facility. Melissa would like to thank everyone who helped with this mission group in any way. So thank you again there. Are there any other announcements this morning? Let us be in the spirit of worship. We gather today giving thanks to God with our whole heart.
Yeah. gather to praise our living God.
When we call on God,
we know that
God will answer. Though we may walk in the midst of trouble,
we know God's right hand will always deliver us.
Amen. Dear God,
we thank you for your constant and reliable love. At times we forget that we can count on you, and we try to do things our own way. As we come together as a community of common life by faith, guide us to lay down our ways and see with new eyes what you have in store for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Once again, welcome to church, welcome to Trinity. It is good to be together this morning, and as we gather, we know that we walk by faith. You may not have a specific reason for coming here today, but in faith you came. When we walk through the doors of Trinity, begin to visit with our friends, recognize familiar faces, and greet people we might not know yet, we know that God is moving through this gathering. Let us now reach out our hand in Christ fellowship to continue to pass the love of God to one another through the passing of the peace of Christ.
As we continue with our service this morning, we invite the children to come up for a word. Hi, guys. How's it going? Oh, beautiful. So, can anybody tell me, what are these? Do you recognize them? Superhero symbols, you're right. And what does this one stand for? Superman? You think so? Superman, yeah. What can he do? Does anybody know? Can he fly? Yeah. Is he strong? Yeah. Does he have lots of different superheroes? powers, yeah. And who's this? Paul, do you know? Yeah, he's a Batman, right?
Batman.
Yeah. I can't do a Batman voice. Does anybody know what Batman can do? He has lots of cool gadgets, doesn't he? He has a cool car that kind of, you know, he can control and comes and saves them when he needs it to. And then, does anybody know what this symbol is? Yep. Wonder Woman, right. Do you know what she can do? She can jump really far, I think. I'm not sure she can fly, but she's super strong, right? She has a lasso that makes people tell the truth, which is pretty cool. And what's this last one? Spider-Man. What can Spider-Man do? He can, like, shoot his web and then swing on it so it looks like he's flying. So they have some pretty cool powers, right? Wouldn't it be cool to have those superpowers? Yeah. Well, we might not have those kind of superpowers, but did you know that we don't really have to wait for Superman to save us? We can make our world better just for ourselves by doing great things in our world. Do you know that? I think you guys have already done some great things here at church or at home or with your parents. So I just want you to keep in mind that as you grow up, you're the ones, you're the superheroes that we're looking to, and you're going to do great things, and you already are doing great things. So these are stickers. So if anybody wants to take some stickers, you can put it right here, and you can be a superhero. Which one you want? Okay. So here, you guys can do that. And before we leave, do you want one? Okay, before you go, let's have a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you for the opportunity to work with you to make our world a better place. I ask your blessing on these children here. May they be a force for good in the world all the days of their lives. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Today's scripture reading is from 1 Samuel chapter 8, verses 4 through 20. Please join me in the bold print. Then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "You are old and your sons do not follow in your ways. Appoint for us then a king to govern us like other nations." But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to govern us." Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. Just as they have done to me from the day I brought them up and out of Egypt to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so also they are doing to you. Now then, listen to their voice. Only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So Samuel reported all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest, and to make his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his courtiers. He will take 1/10 of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and his courtiers. He will take your male and female slaves and the best of your cattle and donkeys and put them to his work. He will take 1/10 of your flocks, and you shall be his slaves. And in that day you will cry out because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves. But the Lord will not answer you the people refused to listen to the voice of Samuel. They said, "No, but we are determined to have a king over us, so that we also may be like other nations, and that our king may govern us and go out before us and fight our battles." So ends the reading.
Let us pray. Dear God, let what I think and what I say be always pleasing to you. Amen. I feel like we might need some backstory on the scripture reading for today. You might know this passage, but just in case, let's take a closer look at it. Before his death, Moses left Joshua in charge as Israel's judge. And after Joshua, a long line of judges followed, each called by God. Samuel was one of those judges, following Eli who came before him. He was called when he was just a small child. God was with him all the days of his life, and he was a just judge. However, his sons, who were set to follow him, were corrupt, seeking profits for themselves and accepting bribes. Because there didn't seem to be a suitable successor to Samuel, the people of Israel saw an opportunity to make a change. His sons were corrupt, and the people were afraid that they would be left without a judge. They saw how other nations worked with a monarch at their head, and they wanted to be like them. This was a distinct move away from being a nation set apart from other nations, as the Israelites had been for generations, and a move toward conformity. They thought they would feel safer if they had a visible authoritarian as their leader. Samuel was not happy about this. He felt this request was a personal rejection of himself. God surprised Samuel by telling him to listen to the people's demands and reassured him it wasn't really a rejection of him, but it was a rejection of God. Wanting a king was seen by God as a form of idolatry because the true king of Israel was supposed to be God. Idolatry was something the Israelites had been struggling with since God brought them out of Egypt. And not to single out the Israelites, but it really seems to be in our human nature to want what we don't have, and especially to want to come for someone to come along and solve our problems for us. We may not want the responsibility that comes from walking in faith with God, and so we look to others to solve our problems for us. It always amazes me how relevant stories in the Bible can be in our own time. The people of Samuel's time were looking for someone to come and be a strong figurehead. They wanted someone who would stand up for Israel and in turn, most importantly, would give them a sense of safety. Does this sound familiar? Have we not seen people rise up in just about every nation at some time or another demanding a leader, even when they might not have been the best choice, because they thought they would bring law and order, stability and security? So God tells Samuel to give the people what they want, but he also advises him to warn them what life being under the rule of a human king would be like. We see Samuel paint a pretty bleak picture of what a monarchy would look like. This could have been because his feelings were still hurt from the people's demands. But in any case, he is definitely displaying the worst possible example of a king. In chapter 11, if we kept reading, we see that they get their king, Saul, a man who was said to be literally head and shoulders above the rest, both physically and in military might. He seemed to be what you would expect a king to be. We'll find out how that turns out next week. And if you know the story, then you already know, spoiler alert, the people God usually picks aren't who you would expect. But even without knowing how it all turns out, I believe this story has a lot in it that is relevant to our time and place. This scripture from the Old Testament, more than anything, makes me wonder why we are always looking for others to solve our problems. Why do we think we need to be ruled over by someone higher than us? And what is our obsession with royalty? Even in our present time, think of the royal wedding that just occurred between Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. It felt like every everyone was interested in that wedding, including me. I watched it too. I'm pretty sure it was my son Carl who said, "I don't get it. Why does everybody care about this?" My response to him at the time was, "I think people want to believe in fairy tales." But now I'm thinking, maybe it's more than that. Recently, I was watching the new Avengers movie, Infinity Wars, which has grossed close to $2 billion since it opened. I'm a big Marvel comic fan, and that movie made me really think about why I like superhero movies. I realized that the main reason I like to watch these movies is because they are a classic battle between good and evil, and good usually wins. Author and professor John McAdder stated in his article, The Gospel According to Marvel, that superheroes and their stories embody our deepest hopes and aspirations and can help us deal with our worst nightmares. Though they are action movies and include lots of special effects, explosions, and chase scenes, these are essentially feel-good movies. I usually leave the theater with a sense that all things are right in the world. In these movies, there is usually an ordinary person who finds themselves in extraordinary circumstances. These circumstances have allowed these heroes to possess some kind of special powers, and they use these powers to try to save the whole world, sometimes the whole universe. These superheroes are working tirelessly, most of the time thanklessly, to save all the nameless and faceless innocent bystanders. But one of the great things about the Marvel heroes are they help us to actually see our role in helping to bring about a better world, since the characters are based in reality and begin as ordinary people who become changed by their circumstances. After their transformation, these characters realize now that they have this extraordinary power, they must use it responsibly. We're always looking for someone or something else to come and save us, to rescue us. But when we watch or read Marvel comics, we see we may just be the ones to help save the world by just embracing our true selves. But sometimes it's hard for us to see our role in bringing about a better world. And I believe it is our tendency to look for someone else to come and save us that made God mad when the people wanted a king. They were afraid because the Philistines were threatening them. And they didn't trust that God would find a way to protect them. They wanted a visible representative to speak on their behalf to the other nations. They wanted someone who would show their military might. They wanted a superhero to go and save their world. But God asks us to walk by faith. Sometimes this is misinterpreted. It doesn't mean you have some kind of immunity and you can step in front of a moving bus and be safe. But it means that you must admit to yourself that God is working within you to lead you toward the right answer. Have you ever felt that tug in one direction, but you thought either God must have been mistaken or had you confused with someone else, so you chose the other path, the one you felt suited you best? And in the end, you can see that if you would have just followed the path that God was attempting to lead you down, you would have been much better off. It isn't that we're puppets, and that God is dictating our every move, but we are being compelled by the Spirit to do the work of God. We're not forced. And it's not like God is constantly leading us down paths where we don't want to go, but there are times in our lives that there are moral, ethical, and spiritual decisions that must be made, and sometimes we make the wrong decisions. So the people of Israel wanted a king. And no amount of warning by Samuel would deter them. So God grants them a king. And just as God had been with the judges, the Spirit of God comes upon Saul as he is anointed as the king of Israel. This just shows us that it's possible for God to use even our bad choices to work toward good. We may sometimes think, well, I screwed this up. This is it. I'm really good at now. I rejected God, I didn't trust God, I went my own way and sought my own superhero. I trusted my own superpowers instead of relying on God. I guess I'm done. I guess there's no coming back from this. We see in the scripture reading that God already knows our nature and knows that we will do this. It's no surprise. Just like 2 weeks ago, I said that God expects fear from us, God also expects rejection and stubbornness. God expects us to think we can do it better on our own. God knows we are human. I think this is the point we forget. God does not expect us to be perfect. We put that on ourselves. God gives grace. We are the ones who are unforgiving of ourselves. Instead of just coming back and starting over, we think we've been cut off. That is not God making us feel that way. That is that shadow part of ourselves that believes the worst about us. That voice that berates us and belittles us, that tells us we aren't worthy of stepping back on God's path. We have always been our worst enemies. We see in the story about the first king of Israel today that God takes our decisions and uses them for good. God can work with whatever we throw God's way. You may be thinking that Samuel did say that on the day that the people cry out about their king, the Lord will not answer them in that day. I believe this is a warning to the people of Israel that the pattern of communication they had become accustomed to with God would be cut off after Samuel is gone. During the time of the judges, when the people had a concern, they came together, they cried out to the judge, then the judge would bring the concern to God, and God would answer. After the days of the judges, that pattern would end. Keeping in mind the rest of the story of Israel, the prophets, and knowing that Jesus came into our world, we can know that it was not an indication that God would be cut off from them indefinitely. This story of the first king of Israel from the Old Testament gives me lots of hope. Because we've seen this pattern throughout human history. We've seen leaders raised up by the people. Sometimes they do horrible things. Sometimes they lead nations astray. They cause wars and make things more difficult for their people. But each time we see God using what humans have done and bringing about healing and restoration. Maybe you can think of instances where this has happened. We see history repeating itself time and time again. But just as Martin Luther King Jr. stated, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Next week, we will see what happens to the superhero King Saul. He was a big, strong guy. He had military wisdom and courage, and he seemed to be the perfect candidate. But as we already know, many times God does not choose the perfect candidate. God usually chooses the least likely person for the job. So I'm going to leave you on a cliffhanger. But if you come back next week, you will hear what happens to King Saul. I hope you see in this scripture reading from today that people thinking all our problems can be solved by a strong authoritarian leader is nothing new. And humans may make bad choices sometimes, but God finds ways to use those bad choices and our resistance against them to bend the moral arc of the universe towards justice, and that we have never done damage beyond repair to our relationship with God, as God knows we will slip from time to time, but it is our willingness to keep coming back that God uses for the good of all. Amen.
Thank you.
continue with our worship service this morning and begin to prepare our offering, we remember that with God's help, we have more power than we know to help our world become a better place. One way we can help is by funding the missions of this church and the church's wider mission. Let us now prepare our offering.